Myself, Amandeep. I'm based in Copenhagen, Denmark, and I work in a fintech company called Ernit. So we are basically a IoT piggy bank and app for the kids, and we integrate with the real bank to give a kid a banking experience. We were part of the Techstar Accelerator in 2016 in New York. So basically, we started our kind of a consuming APIs journey much earlier than PSD2 APIs, open banking APIs started appearing. So this is more or less kind of a talk where I just say the issues, frustrations, differences of opinions, differences of implementation. I'll just try to sum up all as we proceed. I'll say 1/3 of the small audience is banking, so they will know what is the next slide all about. So there is no need to kind of dig through, because there's another dynamism and parameters which apply. Fintech from the consuming side, when you are building any consumer product, there are very conflicting views, within these two articles appear, that definitely means that something is not stable in this field, or something is perceived as challenge, and people have different opinion, but that makes it exciting as well. So we built our first integration. We went live in February of 2018. Sparnoa Bank, which is the fourth largest Danish bank with around 550,000 customer base. So basically, like Ernit, as a consumer app, we require like adult, a parent, and kids to be part of the app, part of the user experience. Adult signs in, parent signs in, gets his list of accounts, assigns, this is my primary account, this is my kid one's account, this is my kid two's account. Each account's balance, and then we have the transaction flow, and with Sparnoa, the separate agreement was that we could also create new account of a kid account, new kid account. Typical integration flow to start with, we agree, we stub, we do this journey 5-6 times, and we come up with the final endpoints that we need. Why specifically? Because we have the certain agree data points. At the same time, like, we have our UX designers who have kind of run into their, you know, the fancy world, that those are scenarios are really not supported. Like, I want to transfer 5 kroner of Danish, 5 euros to each of my kid. So what is this each of my kid? So basically, there are 2 transactions in banking world. So we have to kind of make some step back, some changes in our side. So, and then there are issues like error codes that I'll probably handle separately. And finally, from what app we had, which was running on Funny Money World, and what we had finally with running with Banking World, at least 60% of features we had to cut down. Yeah, so, but we still like still some attitude of gratitude. Okay, this is whatever works. Be happy with it. So dealing with the standards, we started with the PSD2 Berlin Group, Open Banking UK, STET, Poland and Czech, their own standard. And with GDPR, we came with Denmark. For example, Denmark has CPR number, which is a social security number. As per GDPR, it was a personal information. Denmark brought a separate regulation to kind of deregulate it as it's not a personal information anymore. So a lot of conflicting and moving ecosystem. Okay, so the last two are a little outdated here. I replaced in my latest version. That's basically that AISP and PSP license. Oh yeah, so from the tech side, yeah, so it's very interesting. I cannot specifically name certain banks, but let me say this way. Oh, so it's like one particular bank. Okay, so this is our partnership deal, and this once a user logs in, this is the flyweight we are going to provide you. This will have account details, this will have nested account balance and nested transactions with the next page, next page of transactions and all that. This is our API to you. It was such a beautiful anomaly. It is one microservice. which gives everything. So it's not a microservice anymore, right? So are those useful? Yesterday in pre-speaker discussion we had pre-event. What are you saying? The banks will be ready with all the APIs with September. Like, yeah, ready is one thing, useful is another. So, and data conciencing, that's another thing. Maybe we can run into questions. And yeah, so that's more or less here. As an independent fintech company, when we say our actual product is a financial product which requires an integration with the bank, can we do something on our own? We tried. No, it doesn't work. These are the limitations. We cannot communicate on schedule. We cannot have a control on the pilot because people's behavior with real money and funny money is entirely different. Compliance ecosystem, overall integration health, the API endpoints, are they stable enough or they are constantly changing, not just the documentation but the stability overall, payment clearance happening or not happening, so how many times you have to poll before kind of expire, and each bank has its own implementation so far. Essentially this is my last slide, but this should open a lot of questions which I am open for. Yeah. So what is happening? I'll just give a simple example. One bank implements get balance of an account but does not implement list of accounts. So I need to know my list of accounts, then I get to know my balance. Another bank implements list of accounts, yes.
With the bank.
Yeah, so I'll come with account IDs, nested account balance, currency, everything. Other one implements list of accounts with account IDs, just IDs and some more metadata, but no balance. Balance you have to make a separate call. So all these 3, 4, 5 standards. Then there's another thing on account number. Account number some provide, but as per the pre-ASP rules, we cannot save the account number in us. We have to kind of will they provide us account ID? That was one of the discussions at that time. But yeah, that is sorted out after the ASP thing happened. And then same semantics, different APIs. Transactions are transactions with get list of transactions with if modified since, headers and all, there are like various understandings. Consent, a huge, huge mess, I will say. It's like everything is yes or everything is no. So this is our partner bank and they have actually allowed me to talk this. So this partner bank, they signed up two companies, like one us and one other company, which was just doing account information consumption and providing the stats on how the how your spending and everything is. So the list of transactions API, which was exposed to us, it included all the details as an adult I'm accessing my account. Now, if, because there's a provision that I can say that certain transactions should not be listed, should not be shown in my list of transactions, if a third party vendor is getting. So certain, for example, my spending on some shady places. So those do not appear in that list of transactions when this third party gets it. So now the third party is in a two way, like we are the fintech partner company, we get that access. There's a third party which bank assigns for its back end operations, back office operations. There's another list of transactions they get. And as an adult and parent transacting, I need to have the complete visibility that any single kroner change in our account, I should know which transaction item I can attribute to. So there are like three implementations of just one API called list of transactions. I'm talking about early 2018 case. specifically on a get balance call, there's a very aggressive kind of a push towards like this is API and it is cached, but the systems are not ready to push a balance change because, systems are not ready, really. To push a balance change, so basically all the time you have to poll. And if during a polling, you're just hitting the cache endpoint, and it just delays the whole interactive experience. So if the system is not ready to kind of provide a more interactive or fast balance, so don't build cache over there, like keep it for later. Consent revoke over the first is consent. Like, I have a fintech app, and I have my user sign in, and then while connected to the bank, we go to the flow with the bank, and while leaving the app, we take a consent, and when entering the bank takes a consent. So should there be two consent, one consent, that's another thing. That's the thing, like, okay, so user goes through two consent right now at hit app. Other part is the revocation of consent. Revocation of consent, user can send to the bank. So what kind of error codes now we will start getting? But that's not really happening. But in the other case, if the revocation of consent a user sends to us, and we have to push to the bank, what should the bank's endpoint to kind of handle it? Because bank's endpoints are generally, right now, they want like a fresh page, and their own rendered page where you actually provide the items of consent on or consent out. So basically, user's consent, can we capture and send across, or can the bank capture and send us back? So revocation is a much bigger problem. Two consents are okay, still okay. Other thing which is more or less on a kind of a futuristic lines, where should be consent stored? Well, ideally, a user has to trust either a fintech or the bank that here my consent is stored. But in a more rational world with more user activism, consumer activism, where should be consent stored? Like, if that answer is changing, then we have to change as well. We have to kind of make a third place, third party call to somewhere where the user consent is stored. API versioning, somebody spoke about it before. We have mostly talked about REST here, and with open banking, yes, there have been kind of a very proper version changes which have come in last year, and recent being on April, I think, this year. But the thing has been, once you implement a standard and you start building your own versions, I feel like a lot of big companies do not have API version. They just, like, if there is some extra data item, that just gets added. I can say that, like, from the consumer space, like just part Zendesk, HubSpot, like when they expose APIs, they have not got into the versioning world yet. So API is an API, there's no versions there. And over here we have seen the space, like, APIs are not even mature yet, but we are already into fourth version and 3.5 version and all that. So maybe there's no need of versioning, just see which is fitting, which is more useful, which is providing the actual data, that is your API, other one should not just exist. So right to be forgotten, I actually take with the same reason as consent revocation. Consent revocation cascade, we are really not clear on who should inform whom, because as an end user, I can be informing to anyone. So there should be like very standardized flows for consent revocation. Another thing is like consent not being a CRUD. Consent doesn't mean that it is just meant for like either nothing or all. It could be like selective engineering. So these are, you know, more or less my thoughts, and I'm welcome to any questions or some more use cases. Probably I could speak when you have some questions.
General question: why do banks need to work with you guys?
I'm sorry.
Why do banks? What are the benefit banks since exposing your API to
Well, the talk title is like the PSD2.
That's different.
Yeah. Oh, that's different? You're saying that that's different?
Yeah, I mean, every bank has to expose PSD2 related 5 or 6 APIs.
Yeah, but...
Without PSD2, I still can share my product information, price information. That's different. Why do they need to work with it? Because you're taking the customer to
APIscene. Well, but the usefulness of that API has to be in the ecosystem in some way. So banks are like, it's like when they have been mandated, they should just build shitty APIs.
Yeah.
It's mandated only for regulation and technical mandation.
You know?
Not a business mandation, right?
Hard as I'm with you, but it's like...
No, I'm asking a business, yes, business question.
Totally with you on this part, like, okay, there's no motivation, and then when you are forced something and... you end up doing something which you don't want, fine. But the thing is that when you enter, when you say that, at the same time, I'm also saying that, I'm sorry if I'm upsetting anyone. Why do a lot of these hackathons or incubators are happening by banks? Because bank wants those guinea pigs, fintechs, to come and test their APIs, right? Yeah? So at least standing on that ethic, that they should provide something meaningful for them to use. Yes, if they don't want to expose and they don't want to build something totally irrelevant, fine.
Well, some banks surely do consider themselves consumers.
Yes.
Well, BBVA story is one thing, yeah?
Yes.
But...
No, I'm just speaking the negative.
But there is offensive open banking part, yes? The classic scenario is the credit history, basically, the credit score kind of information. The cheapest source is other banks, but the problem is that if the other banks don't expose their data, well, you will not get it. So you need to expose yours to get the other. That's the simplest case, yeah, of like mutual. So in the ecosystem, there are savings, yes, in such a scenario. Each of them loses a bit, let's say, on the let's say competitiveness. Yes. However, they can save on as a whole.
Yeah. On the other side, like just to add to this, like get balance API should be exposed. Fine. So how late is the balance should be? There's no kind of a defined rule for that. The balance should be like a 10-minute old or like a 4 days old. So just do. But again, it's the usefulness and competitiveness. One more question, I say.
Other questions?
Yeah. Well, there was I had a technical question in mind regarding the preferred way of sort of offering push title APIs. So would you prefer webhooks or web sockets, or maybe MQTT protocol on top of them, or what?
So webhooks the most preferred ones. Webhook post made.
Do you have an endpoint that we post this type of stuff there?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, right now the banking ecosystem, we are in like. Real backend is mainframe, so they have to build their own boarding service to train pushes. Yeah, we're hoping we're ready. Actually, in MAS, Singapore is a standard monetary authority of Singapore. When they publish the standard document, and actually that's a very contrasting case with PSD2. 146-page document clarifies which API with parameters, and the whole thing is delivered. And webhook is also webhook push notification also part of that.
I think if you look at a Beyond perspective, Beyond is a banking information architecture. I think you might know that, and they are getting most of the banks into their network to define the standards, so that everybody follows the standards and give the workflows. So it is picking up slowly, but again the question comes back to saying, what is it following? When you expose the data. Without PSD2, you still can do web scanning, whatever the web, get the information back, right? But still, okay, if you are a good user, right? If I'm exposing my data, what is it from?
One 5 second statement here. Just to kind of add that here. Singapore Fintech, we are actually part of the Singapore Fintech Festival. So, Standard Chartered, who was implementing this, and they reached out to Oracle, and just it's like a complete banking infrastructure available. Give the Docker image to all the banks and let them all use it. Let it be same standard. If somebody has to really impose regulation wise, So let it be very specific standard article. Right now it's all mess. Yeah, that's all.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah.